Any questions or comments you have from what we have covered and what Mr. Lowe did on Wednesday? Okay. Do you have any suggestions for what we should do on Monday and Wednesday? I again have to be out of town. I'm sorry. I think this time four students from this class will also be with us. It's again a requirement from the program managers. Every year we have to go and report what we have done in the previous year and what we will do in the following year. So yesterday and day before yesterday, I was with the Office of Naval Research doing basically same what my group had done during the past year and what we plan on doing next year. On Monday, the meeting is with the Army Research Office. So same thing, we have to report what we have done or what we did in the last year and then what we will do in the following year. If they like what both things, then we are in business, which means we can support students. And if they don't like, both the students and the faculty members are in trouble. So, sorry, I mean, this is part of the job. It's not that I'm going there for vacation. Believe me, it's not vacation. I arrived home last night at midnight. So it's not really a vacation because when I arrived last night and then we go back on Sunday. So don't think that I'm goofing off. So, do you have any suggestions how to make it up? I mean, of course, we will have extra classes. So I have to figure it out when we will have them. And I can, if it is helpful, I can ask Mr. Law to come and talk to you. But if it's not helpful, then there is no point in wasting your and his time. Any questions or comments? Okay, so I assume it's not helpful. So we will meet a week from today. So the next class will be a week from today. Yes? No, the homework is due on Friday. The homework that was supposed to be due on Monday will be due on Friday. Yeah, now you are happy.
We're on Vox here.
So the homework that I had said was due on Monday will be due a week from today. Okay. So let's review what we were doing. So to refresh your memory, we have this body which we denote by a potato. The coordinates of any point in the body are denoted by uppercase letter X, which stands for x1, x2, and x3. That are the coordinates of a point with respect to a rectangular Cartesian coordinate system. And because of the loads applied to the body, so this point P moves to P prime, and its coordinates become little xi. And both of these are with respect to the same coordinate system. And in this course, we will use only rectangular Cartesian coordinate system. Even though sometimes it's convenient to use spherical or cylindrical coordinates, but we will use only rectangular Cartesian coordinates. So the fact that each material particle occupies a unique place in space is indicated by this equation, where I goes from I has 1, 2, and 3, so these are three equations, and point Q, which is close to it, and has coordinates x plus dx, will have coordinates xi plus dxi in the deformed state. And then you can subtract one from two, and you get dxi, which are the coordinates of p prime, q prime. So if you subtract and then use the Taylor series expansion, so this is what we end up with. Now remember, when we are using the Taylor series expansion, yes?
Could you keep the papers in one place? Because every time you use it, okay. It gets blurry.
Yeah, thanks.
Can you show us what's at the bottom?
You have this in your notes. This is from last time.
Okay.
So this is it. Actually, otherwise I will be writing with a pen, so I will be slower. This is a review of, so this is an advantage of having these sheets. Otherwise I will have to write in the chalkboard, which will take more time. So this is already in your notes. This is nothing new yet. So this P prime Q prime, that is the position vector in the deformed state. We are denoting it by dxi, little dxi. So that's the position of point Q prime minus the position of point P prime. Now we are expanding the first term in Taylor series. Now remember, time is kept fixed. So time is not changing. What we are doing is we are comparing the position of PQ with that of P prime Q prime. So you take, this is the undeformed state, my arm. It's undeformed state. Now if I pull it, that's a deformed state. So what we are trying to find is how much pull we have exerted on this arm. We are not going to find the force today. What we are going to find is the change in lengths and the change in angles. So if you draw a square on my arm, like on your arm, and then pull it, you should be able to see that the square is deformed into a rectangle. If you draw a circle, you will see it is deformed into an ellipse. Because on the surface, you cannot see three-dimensional pictures. So if you like, you can take a sheet of rubber and draw a circle or a rectangle on or a square on it, and if you stretch it, you will see that a square is deformed into a rectangle and a circle is deformed into an ellipse. So I encourage you to do that experiment, not necessarily on your arm, but if you have a washable ink, it won't hurt you. And if you don't have a washable ink, then it will take a week or two before it's wiped off. Okay, so this vector then, P prime Q prime, by expanding in terms of Taylor series, we are keeping only the first term here, first order term, which means first order terms in dx. The assumption is that dx, the points P and Q we are considering are very close to each other. We are not saying anything about the stretch. We are not saying anything about the deformation. The deformations can be large, 100%, 1000%, 500%, even 1000000% is okay. All we are saying is we will take vectors PQ in the undeformed state, which is very small. So the points Q and P are very close to each other. And in a minute, we are going to divide by the length of PQ. So it doesn't matter how close or how far they were. But if they are far, then this approximation is not good. Okay. So this approximation is good only when P and Q are very close to each other. So this quantity, delta XI over delta XA, we call deformation gradient because this is the gradient of deformation. And we are going to evaluate it at point P. So the point P is fixed for us. So DXI, that means the deformed vector is related to the undeformed vector by this relationship. And this approximation is because we have neglected the second order terms in dx and the third order terms in dx. So if dx is very small, if this quantity in the box is very small, then the approximation is good. Otherwise, it's not good. So a deformation, now this part is new, so a deformation in which and I will ask you this question in the exam. So I assume you are aware. Because I'm telling you what I will ask you. Somebody asked me, will I give out any trial test? The answer is no. Half of the test will be true or false. Roughly 20 questions, 25 questions. They don't. It's true or false. You don't have to do any calculation. It's 2 plus 2. The answer is 4 or 4. There will be 2 or 3 answers given. Or it might say, is 2 plus 2 equal to 4? You say either yes or no. Okay? So a deformation. In which or for which FIA is a constant, is a function of time only, is called a homogeneous deformation. So if f is a function of time only, then it's a homogeneous deformation. Otherwise, if it is a function of x and time, it's an inhomogeneous deformation. Now, 99.9% of the experimentalists assume that the deformation is homogeneous. Otherwise, whatever we are measuring with a strain gauge is the average over the length of the strain gauge. Whatever you are measuring, like elongation or anything else, this is average over the length of the strain gauge. Now, if the deformation is uniform, like constant, then the average is the same as the deformation itself. Average of 2 plus 2 is 2. So if the deformation is constant, then doesn't matter how big or how small your strain gauge is, you will be finding the actual deformation. Otherwise, you are measuring average deformation, which is not necessarily the deformation at a point. Okay, so if we have something like this, xi equal to AIL, which may be a function of time, then the deformation is homogeneous. Because, so for a homogeneous deformation, little xi must equal a, which is a function of time, operating upon x, plus a constant, which is a function of time. And if you differentiate it, you will get fi is equal to delta xi over delta xl. Maybe choice is not good, so let's say fil is delta xi over delta xl, which is AIL, and that's a function of time only, which means it's uniform over the body. It's not very easy to produce a homogeneous deformation. We will like to, but in most cases we cannot. So the tests in which we can produce homogeneous deformation are simple tension, which means you take a specimen, and apply loads at the ends, so that's what is simple tension. So it's very likely that deformation in this portion, which is away from the ends, will be uniform, will be constant. And you try to put your strain gauge away from the grips. What will happen if I twist it? If I take this circular, say, shaft or a circular bar and apply torque, like, so one end is fixed and apply twist on the other end, will the deformation be uniform? And all of you, most of you have studied this problem in your mechanics of deforms class. Will the deformation be homogeneous? Again, the answer is yes or no. Pardon? Anyone ventures to guess? Is my question clear? So we do the torsion test in a lab. So will the deformation be homogeneous? No, it will not be homogeneous. These strains are not constant throughout the radius. Okay. Same thing if you take a beam and says and apply loads to it. Will the deformation be homogeneous? No, it will not be. Now for the torsion case, we can make this hollow so the thickness is small as compared to the radius. We can approach, we cannot get, we can approach a homogeneous state of deformation. Because the thickness is very small, so the variation of strain through the thickness will be small. Small, it doesn't mean there will be no variation of thickness. So the problem there will come up that if you make the thickness very small, the tube will buckle before you can twist it too much. So you gain some, you lose some. Okay, now let's go back to our equation, dxi equals fia dxa. So what will be the length of the element in the deformed state? So in the undeformed state, it is the vector is dx, big dx. In the deformed state, it is little dx. So what is the length? Length is, again, this we did last time. So the length is dxi, that's the square of the length. So it's dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dx3 square, or dx square plus dy square plus dz square. So this is the length, which we can say it is ds square. Well, we have there ds square over. So if we take this unit vector m equal to pq over the length of pq, so that's where it doesn't matter how close or how distant pq are, except in the Taylor series approximation. Then we get the ratio of ds square over big ds square equal to fia, fib, dxa over ds, which is a unit vector m, dxb over ds is a unit vector m. Now this quantity, the one I'm putting in the blue box, how many free indices does it have? Two. So we will denote it by CAB. Each component of CAB is the sum of nine terms. Remember, I is summed, so CAB is the sum of nine terms. Each component of C is the sum of nine terms. So what we have then is ds square over big ds square equals CAB, MA, MB. Where M is the vector DXA over DS, so it's a unit vector along PQ. Now in your undergraduate class, you learned that the change in length per unit length is called axial strain. Change in length per unit length is axial strain. Here, we are going to compare the squares of lengths. We are going to compare the squares of lengths rather than the lengths themselves. So it's the square of the final length minus square of the initial length of the same vector in the undeformed state over the initial length square. It's still non-dimensional, except it is not changing length per unit length. So this thing, basically what I have done is I have subtracted one from both sides. So if I subtract one, if I subtract one from both sides, so I can write the left hand side as ds square, little ds square minus big ds square over ds square. Now this one, I'm going to write it as, say, ma, mb, because m is a unit vector, so I can write m dot m is 1. M is a unit vector, so m dot m is 1. Now, this m, I'm going to write as I think none of you corrected me. It should have been MA, MA. So M dot M is MA, MA. So this MA, I'm writing as unit matrix or delta AB, MB. And the reason is I can take MA and MB common factor. So I can write this thing as CAB minus delta AB MA MB. M is a unit vector passing through the point P in the undeformed state. So M is the direction in which we have applied the strain gauge. M is the direction in which we have applied a strain gauge. So what we are finding is the reading of the strain gauge, except we are comparing squares of lengths rather than the lengths themselves. Now, if the strains are small, for small changes in length, so we can say ds is big ds where epsilon is, so when we say epsilon is small, we say epsilon is much, much less than 1. I think you have a question. Speak up. When we say epsilon is small, we mean it is much, much less than 1, like it could be 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 8, meaning thereby that epsilon square is negligible as compared to epsilon. Epsilon square and epsilon cube are negligible as compared to epsilon. which, I mean, if you take epsilon as 0.8, which is less than 1, epsilon squared will be 0.64. It is not negligible as compared to 0.8. But if you take epsilon as 10 to the minus 3, then epsilon squared will be 10 to the minus 6, which is negligible as compared to 10 to the minus 3. So it's all relative. And what is small to you may not be small to me, and vice versa. So now if we find ds square minus big ds square over ds square, so we get 1 plus epsilon square minus 1 over 1, and that's 1. So that's 2 epsilon plus epsilon square. And so that's, in the approximation then, that's 2 epsilon. So if epsilon is small, if the change in length is small, then ds square minus big ds square is roughly twice over ds square is twice of epsilon. So we are not violating what the small, for small strains, we can compare either changes in length over initial length or changes in the squares of length over the square of the initial length. So for small strains, we are okay. Now for large strains, which means 1000% or 500% or 20% or 50%, we cannot neglect epsilon squared as compared to epsilon. Okay? So this definition is good all the time, whereas the one we learned in the mechanics of deforms class, change in length per unit length is good for small strains. Okay. This one, the quantity in the box, we will denote by twice EAB. And this is big E, like uppercase E. And that 2, this factor of 2 is meant to cancel with that 2. So the definition of strain will come out to be change in length per unit length. So this uppercase E is a strain. The factor of 2 is meant to cancel with this 2. Now these quantities we have introduced, C's and E's, they have a name. So we are paying tribute to the people who introduced them first. So C is called Wright. Wright is not the name of a person. Wright is like left and right. Cauchy is the name of a person. You will hear Cauchy million times in this class. So he's the father, he's the father of continuum mechanics we are studying. So this Cauchy, green tensor. This is called right Cauchy green tensor, and there will be left Cauchy green tensor also. Again, left and right means directions, like they are nothing to do with the name of a person. Cauchy is one mathematician, green is another mathematician. So Cauchy green tensor. E is called green. Now, depending upon which book you use, the second author you will see different. So I'm going to follow from whom I learned, and I'm going to use whatever he suggested. He did the historical survey. I did not do the historical survey. I cannot read Latin, and I cannot read Italian and German, but he could. Professor Trussell could read 8 languages. So he studied, and so this terminology is from him. So it's called green Saint Venant strain tensor. ST is for Saint, S-A-I-N-T. Like Saint Louis, we usually write ST period. this is the same ST. So it's saint, like Pope blessed with sainthood. So that's this saint, that saint, S-A-I-N-T. Okay. So this is called Green Saint Venant Stain Tensor. So we have introduced Cauchy Green Stain Tensor, and we have introduced Green Saint Venant Stain Tensor. So CAB is FIA, FIB, EAB is 1/2 CAB minus delta AB. I'm just rewriting what I have already written there. So in the reference configuration, when there is no deformation, in the reference configuration, like in the undeformed state, what is the value of C? In the undeformed state, when we have not applied any loads to the body, what will be the value of C? C is a tensor, right? It has 9 components, but it's symmetric. Because if you interchange A and B, you get the same thing. So it's really 6 components. So CAB is same as CBA, and same thing here. Yes?
This is the
Kronecker delta. So in the undeformed state, so in the reference configuration, CAB equals delta AB and EAB equals 0. Engineers like you and I like to work with quantities which start from 0. So that's one reason people like to use E rather than C. Both are equivalent. The only difference is you add or subtract the Kronecker delta. So it does not make any difference which one you use. Okay, now the next question comes. How do I interpret this C and E? So let's look at, say, this quantity. And let's take M as 1, 0, 0. Let's take the vector M we start with as the vector, as a unit vector pointing along x1 axis. So what is MA equal to then in terms of components? How will I write this? See, what I wrote is a vector, like 3 components of a vector. Now I want to write that as an equation. So what is MA equal to? I don't want to change the meaning of M. It's the same vector. So what will, how will I write M? Yes?
Delta 1A.
Delta 1A. Very good. So this is delta 1A or delta A1, which is the same thing. So ds square minus big ds square over big ds square. So now I'm taking a very specific choice of M. I'm taking a vector parallel to the x1 axis. So I'm taking a vector parallel to the x1 axis. I should not write this. Let me write only the ds square over big ds square. So I don't have to subtract 1. So let me just write ds square over ds square. So this is what I have there. But you cannot see both of them. Okay, so I'm using this equation. And I'm choosing my MA as delta IA. So I'm choosing MA as delta IA. So what is the ds square over d big S square? So that's CAB delta 1 A delta 1 B. We substitute for MA and MB. So you substitute for MA and MB. So we have learned that A and A is summed, so that gives us 1. B and B is summed, so that gives us 1. So it's really C11. So we get an interpretation for C11, physical interpretation. So what does C11 mean? C11 means it is the square of the final length of the vector that initially, that originally was along x1 axis and was of unit length. Okay, so if you like, you can say little ds over big ds is square root of C11. And that we said is stretch at point P. Now we will say it is along the unit vector 1, 0, 0. So square root of C11 is the stretch. Stretch means final length over initial length. Stretch means final length over initial length. Yes?
What is that subscript?
Oh, 1, 0, 0? Oh. That is the initial vector.
Okay.
See, we took the M as 1, 0, 0. So C11 is the square of the stretch along x1 axis. What will be C22? What will be C22?
The x2 axis.
X2, all you do is change 1 to 2, 1 to 2, 1 to 2, you will get 2 here. So C22 is the square of the stretch of a vector parallel to the x2 axis. C33 is the square of the stretch of a vector parallel to x3 axis. Okay? Yes?
What is the P?
The superscript P?
P is the point where you are measuring the stretches. If the deformation is not homogeneous, then stretch will be different at different points. So P is the point where you are finding the strains. And 1, 0, 0 is the direction along which you are finding. Like axial strain is, so 1, 0, 0 is the direction along which you have put a strain gauge. And P is the point where you have put the strain gauge. Okay, now, of course, we also want to find not only the change in length, but we want to find the change in angles. So let's take our reference configuration again in the shape of a potato. So we have point P, and now I take two vectors, PQ and PR. So take two vectors, PQ and PR, and they are deformed into P goes to P prime, Q goes to Q prime, and R goes to R prime. So the angle between PQ and PR has changed. Okay? So PQ, or P prime, Q prime, I, is FIA evaluated at point P times PQA. P prime R prime . So we are evaluating at the same point. All we are doing is replacing PQ by PR. Replacing PQ by PR. Is it okay? So now, take the inner product. Take the inner product of these two vectors. That's what we mean by inner product, like AX, BX plus AY, BY plus AZ, BZ. I is summed, I is repeated. And on the left hand side, we will get FIA, FIB, PQA, PQB. Sorry, on the right hand side, we will get FIA, FIB, and both of these are evaluated at point P. Yes?
So the second one is PR.
Oh, yeah, second one is PR, right. Yeah, thank you. Second one is PR. Does it make sense? Any questions about this? So what about the left-hand side now? How can I write in terms of angles? So this angle, you know, you start with, say. And this is the new angle. How can we find angle between two vectors from the inner product? It's not a hard question. What is the inner product of vectors A and B equal to in terms of the angle between A and B? It's the vector A, length of vector A, multiplied with length of vector B, times cosine of the angle between them. So if this angle is theta, so this will equal length of vector P prime Q prime, length of vector P prime R prime, cosine theta, and this is equal to CAB, evaluated at the point P, which I'm not writing now, times PQA, PRB. Is it okay if I, let me keep on writing P. So it's evaluated at the point P. We said FIA, FIB is the right Cauchy-Green tensor. So we denoted that by C. So what we are saying is this quantity in the box is C. The quantity in the box, like FIA, FIB, is CAB. So you know the initial angle between lines PQ and PR, because you know the vectors PQ and PR. You chose them. You find their deformed positions. If you know F, you know F. If you know the deformation, if you are given this, then you can find F at any point. So if you are given the deformation, so the problem in mechanics is finding the deformation. Okay. Here we are starting with the deformation. So we really are not solving the problem. So our goal in mechanics is to find this function. That's what you will be paid for. You will be given the shape of a body, loads acting on it, the material of the body, and what you have to do is find this shape, find the deformed shape. Here we are assuming the deformed shape is given to us by some magic. So if it is given, you can find the deformation gradient. And if you know the deformation gradient, you can find C. And if you know C, you can find the change in angle between any two lines. remember, we just found in the previous case, like ds square over big ds square. So we know the changes in lengths. We know the ratio of lengths. What we are doing now is finding the changes in angles. So what C does, six components of C. Three components are diagonal, C11, C22, C33. So what does C22 give us? Oh, please press that button and...
Change in length on M2 or X2.
Change in the length of a vector initially parallel to the X2 axis. It's really the square of the final length over initial length. The off-diagonal components, C12, C23, and C31, they determine the changes in angles. So all six components are important. For example, now, let's take PQ as epsilon, which is the magnitude of the vector, times delta A1. So that's a vector, that's a vector of length epsilon parallel to the x1 axis in the undeformed state. Right? It's a vector parallel to the x1 axis in the undeformed state. Take PR and let's put this length epsilon 1, this is length epsilon 2. And this is a vector parallel to the x2 axis in the undeformed state. These are not unit vectors. Their lengths are epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. So if we substitute for these in here, what we get then is P prime, Q prime, the length of P prime, Q prime, the length of P prime, R prime, cosine theta equal to epsilon 1, epsilon 2, CAB, delta A1, delta B2. Because we have such PRB, not PRA. So the index on PR is B, so that's why we are putting delta B2. Am I making sense? We are substituting for PQ and PR. So what will be this quantity equal to? So if you are not sure, you can write longhand, but you know Kronecker delta's property. A has to be 1, otherwise it is 0. So this is equal to epsilon 1, epsilon 2, C12. Unless A is 1, you get 0. So that means this A on C is replaced by 1, and B is replaced by 2. So what is P prime, Q prime, length of P prime, Q prime, over epsilon 1, length of P prime R prime over epsilon 2. So that equals cosine theta equals C12. I hope you can read. This is cosine theta equal to C12. So what is P prime, Q prime, length of P prime, Q prime over epsilon 1? One of you answered this question before. So what is the length of P prime, Q prime over epsilon 1? Samitha at Wake Forest?
I don't know.
Melissa at Wake Forest?
It's 1.
No, it's final length over initial length.
The stretch.
stretch. Very good. So it's stretch along x1 axis. So this is stretch along x1 axis. This is stretch along x2 axis. Cosine theta equal to c12. So if you know stretches along x1 and x2 axis, which really means c11 and c22. See, stretches along x1 and x2 axis are determined by c11 and c22. Yes?
Shouldn't that second lambda be 0, 1, 0?
Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'm sleepy. 0, 1. You are right. Absolutely right. Thank you. Yeah. So the second one should be 0, 1, 0. So this stretch along x1 axis multiplied by stretch along x2 axis, cosine of theta gives you c12. So the off-diagonal components, c12, c23, and c31, they give us changes in angles between lines that were initially parallel to x1 and x2 axis, or x2 and x3 axis, or x3 and x1 axis. So that is the physical interpretation of the components of C. The diagonal components give us squares of stretches, and off-diagonal components give us changes in angles. And that's what you want to know. A deformation is nothing more than finding the changes in lengths and finding changes in angles. So I see most of you are looking at the time when time is over. So any questions about what we have done? So in summary, what we have done is, if you know the deformation gradient f at a point, from f you can find c, right, Cauchy-Green tensor. From c you can find the squares of stretches or changes in length, finite length, and you can find the changes in angles between any two lines in the undeformed state. And that gives you all of the information you need to find the deformation. So you should be able to do your homeworks now. And that is due on Friday. There is no class on Monday and Wednesday of next week.